Hi, this is Charley Hesse, and welcome to this virtual bird tour of Okinawa, Amami, Sado, and Miyagi. These are locations not included on the main Japan tour. It's very much a best of the rest compilation video. I lived in Japan for 5 years, and I made many trips to Okinawa. It's a very special place. Many of you may know how obsessed I am with Japan, and Okinawa is actually my favorite place in Japan. And it's really one of my favorite places in the world. I've got a real love for the music and the culture and the wildlife. There's some really special things there. So I'm very excited to share those with you today. As usual, we're going to start with a map of the region. It shows the Japanese archipelago from Hokkaido up in the north down to the very far southwest, close to Taiwan. We're going to be concentrating on these southwest islands called the Nansei Shoto, literally southwest islands, or the Ryukyu Islands. Ryukyu was a kingdom for about 450 years until 1879, when it was annexed by Japan and incorporated. And there's a lot of Ryukyu endemics. We're going to be concentrating on two of the larger islands, on the main island of Okinawa and on Amami. There are a lot of other interesting islands too, the Yaeyama Islands you can see here off to the west, with some other wonderful things to see there. And there's actually a new species of bird there, a recently split bird called the Iriomote Tit. And also there's a wildcat, the Iriomote Wildcat, so if you wanted to, it would also be possible to go and visit Iriomote. We're going to zoom in on the main island of Okinawa. The capital of Okinawa is Naha in the south, and you can see there's a lot more development in the south, a lot more green forest in the north. So we arrive at the airport in Naha, and we're going to drive straight up to the north of the island. On the way, we may stop at some little rest areas with a lot of gift shops. This whole area is just absolutely mad about Okinawa rails. You get Okinawa rail cookies and fridge magnets and bags and postcards and everything imaginable. It's absolutely amazing. I did take my family there a couple of years ago, and here's my son with a big stuffed Okinawa rail, and also dancing in traditional costume and scaring a little Okinawa rail away. My family really enjoyed it here too. There's even an Okinawa Rail cafe just along a beautiful forested road with Okinawa Rails nearby. And they do a very good cheesecake. We're going to arrive at our lodge, which is called Manabi no Mori, or the Learning Forest. And as you can see, it's surrounded by a beautiful subtropical forest. And there's actually now just recently been designated a national park, the Yambaru National Park, just in 2016. Here's a little view of the lodge itself. Very nice modern buildings, wonderful restaurant. And you can see there's a little hill up here that you can climb up. From up here, you get a wonderful view, 360 all around. And you can see you are right in the middle of this gorgeous forest. From our lodge, we're going to start exploring the north end of the island. You can see these low mountains are covered with beautiful forest, and they're all crisscrossed by little mountain forest roads, and it makes it really convenient to access some really nice habitat. This is some of the habitat that we're going to explore. As you can see, there's a lot of tree ferns here. It's not really very tall forest, but it's quite lush. Subtropical evergreen, and you can see another little stretch of forest here. So yeah, really good birding. This whole area is just full of signs warning you of Okinawa rails running in the roads. Here it says tobidashi chui, so they can sort of run out at any time. Another one warning of rails running out into the road, and there's even some in English. And here is a big statue of an Okinawa rail. There have been some collisions, and they even give a phone number here in case a bird is hit and injured, and you can contact them. As well as collisions with cars, Okinawa rails are also threatened by predation by introduced predators like this mongoose, and also feral cats are a big problem. This is a nice view of the forest that we're going to be exploring. As well as birding along the road, we can also walk along some forest tracks. Some of the common birds that we're going to see are things like this Japanese tit, which is an Okinawan subspecies. Also varied tit, another Okinawan subspecies. This is a Ryukyu endemic. This is a Ryukyu robin, or Okinawa robin, a bit split. You notice this one has got a white belly with no black on the sides. This is the female here. Another one of our big targets is the Okinawa woodpecker. This is one of the rarest woodpeckers in the world. It's critically endangered, and there's probably only a couple of hundred of them left. But still, we should have a good chance to see them. Really uniquely colored, this kind of brown color, red belly, and this beautiful ivory colored bill. Some other birds that we're going to be looking for, the local subspecies of whistling green pigeon. And some other animals as well, like this sword-tailed newt. We're going to be doing some night drives. We've got a few targets to look for at night. Often on the roads at night, you can see this beautiful snake called the akamata. It looks terribly dangerous, but it's actually non-venomous. This is another animal that we might be lucky enough to see at night. It's called the Ryukyu Longford Rat. Another mammal we might see is the Ryukyu Flying Fox. And sometimes you even see sleeping birds like this ruddy kingfisher. Of course, we're going to be looking for owls. This is a fairly common owl. It's called the Ryukyu Scops Owl. And another interesting owl is the Japanese Scops Owl. This is a Ryukyu endemic subspecies, and it has a good chance of being split as a separate species. Of course, our main target is the Okinawa rail. They can be quite vocal at night. So while we're driving along looking for other things, we're going to be listening out for this. And if we hear one call, then we might have a chance to see it roosting. The next morning, very early, at dawn, we're going to start driving very slowly along the roads. And there's a few stretches of roads where Okinawa rails often come out on the edge like this. And if we're lucky, we might get to see one. This was only discovered, I think, around 1980, described 1981. But a really amazing bird. This is one of my favorite birds in the world. So with a bit of luck, we should get to see it. After exploring Kunigami, we're going to start heading south. On the way, we're going to stop at a town called Kin, and it's got a few rice fields. There's not that many rice fields in Okinawa, but in winter, they're home to a lot of wintering birds, so it's a good way to pad the trip list a little bit. This is a sort of habitat that we're going to be birding, just open rice fields. Sometimes they're flooded, sometimes dry. And then up here also, you can see a lot of the edges have got bushes and trees with a lot of other birds as well. Some of the birds we might see in Kin are the eastern spot-billed duck. In some of the paddy fields, we might see little ring plovers, long-toed stints, and temic stints. And also in some of the grassy fields, we might find a common snipe. There's also a lot of pipits and wagtails, including the eastern yellow wagtail. And a common raptor in winter is this grey-faced buzzard. Large-billed crows are common throughout Japan, but there's a very localized subspecies here that's actually very, very small. You can see one here feeding on the daigo flower, a very special flower in Okinawa. Some of the birds that we might see include the brown-eared bulbul. And this used to be the Japanese white-eye. It's now called the warbling white-eye, but another localized subspecies. This bird is called the Japanese bush warbler. It's not a lot to look at, but it's got a very distinctive and beautiful song. And it's actually the best known song of any bird in Japan. It says Ho Kokikyo, and is often the sound of spring, but even in late winter, that started calling in Okinawa, another localized subspecies. From Kin, we're going to drive back to Naha. And just before we fly out, we're going to visit a couple of birding sites here. One is the Mankor Waterbird and Wetland Reserve, which is very good for shorebirds. And another place we're going to be visiting is called Triangle Pond. You can see it's totally developed, this area, totally concrete, but there's a little triangular pond with some mud and reeds, and it's just absolutely packed with birds. Some of the birds that we can expect to find in this area include the common kingfisher, the black-winged stilt, redneck stint. Here's a grey-tailed tattler with its head tucked away, but you can see its bright yellow legs. One of the main targets is the Saunders gull, a globally threatened species, and there's usually a few individuals around Naha. Another bird is the endangered black-faced spoonbill, and there's quite a few birds that winter in this area. Here's some footage of black-faced spoonbills preening here. You can see we're quite close to the airport here, and then from Okinawa we're going to be flying just a short flight to our next destination, which is Amami Island. Amami Island is quite famous for its beautiful beaches and beautiful blue oceans. A lot of regular tourists come here for those things, and you can see there's a really nice coastline here. From the airport, we're going to be heading up into the hills, and we're going to bird a nice place called Kinsakubaru, where there's some nice primary forest. This area is also quite famous for its tree ferns, and they make for some wonderful photos. Here's some forest we're going to be exploring, some wonderful birding in here. We've got quite a few difficult targets, so we're going to be spending 3 nights on Amami. Some common birds we're going to be looking for include the Japanese tit again, but this is an endemic subspecies to Amami Island. We should also find some Ryukyu minivets, which is a Japanese endemic. This is a Narcissus flycatcher, but it's a Ryukyu endemic subspecies with a green crown. Very beautiful bird. This again is the Ryukyu robin, but you'll notice on this one it has black flanks. This is a possible split as a separate species. We might not see this in winter because the birds breed here on Amami and they go in winter down in the Yaoyama Islands, but if you come here in spring you should see them. This is a big target. This is a white-back woodpecker, but this particular subspecies, O. stoni, is an endemic. And it's a pretty likely split. It's already split by HBW as the Amami woodpecker. But yeah, this has a very good chance to be split as a separate species. We're also going to be looking for Japanese wood pigeon. And our next Amami endemic, the Lids Jay or Amami Jay. Totally unique looking bird, sort of purple head and maroon belly. And this ivory colored bill with this white streaking on the throat. Stunning birds. How Amami ended up with at least 3 endemic species of birds is really amazing. This is our next target, not an easy bird to see. This is now the Amami thrush. It was split and then lumped and then split again, so hopefully it will stay split. It's a very secretive bird. It's going to be one of the tougher birds to find, but we've got a good chance to find it. In Japanese, they call this O Toratsugumi, the large tiger thrush. We're also going to be going out at night here. We might come across this very impressive snake called the Habu, which is quite a venomous species. Going to be watching where we walk. We're going to be looking for other owls. Here's another owl that we might find, the northern Bubuk. This particular race is another Ryukyu endemic subspecies that also could be split. And our main target at night is going to be the Amami woodcock. We've got a good chance to see this really impressive bird. As well as the endemic birds, there's actually an endemic mammal on Amami, or Amami on the neighbouring island. The Amami black rabbit. It's a very primitive species and really weird looking. I mean, it looks almost like a wombat. Also, with a bit of luck, we should find one of these. After finishing our birding in the forests of Amami, I'm going to head back to the airport and then fly up to Tokyo, where we finish the extension. This is a pre-tour extension to our main Japan in Winter tour, although it does also feature on our Japan in Spring tour. In Tokyo, we'll meet up with other people joining the main tour of the Japan in Winter, and of course you can see my other Japan in Winter virtual tour. But after the Japan in Winter main tour and extension, we may offer a new extension up to the north of Honshu, where we're going to go and look for some very special birds. As a tourist in Japan, one of the big highlights is to ride the famous bullet train, which we don't do on the main tour. But on this extension, we are going to go down to Tokyo Station, where we're going to get on the bullet train. Here you can see the wonderfully shaped bullet train, very futuristic. And from Tokyo, we are going to go quite far up to Niigata Prefecture. But on the bullet train, it only takes 2 hours. And so we'll arrive there in comfort. And from there, we are going to visit the island of Sado. From Niigata, we are going to take a fast boat across to Sado Island. Only takes 1 hour. As you can see here, it's just a short jump across to Sado Island, and we arrive at Ryotsu Ferry Terminal. This is full of gift shops selling souvenirs, and you've never seen so many products devoted to one bird. There's probably 10 shops in here, and they're all full of Japanese crested ibis memorabilia. It's pretty impressive. The Japanese are very big into giving souvenirs, and there's just everything imaginable, from little cookies and chocolates to fridge magnets and postcards and bags and clothes and just anything you can imagine. From the ferry terminal, we are going to head to Tokinomori, which was a breeding center for the crested ibis. On the way, we're going to pass some road signs telling us to drive slowly. And here we are arriving at the breeding center. Here there's even a Japanese crested ibis postbox. So there's quite a sad story about the Japanese crested ibis in Japan. I think in 1981, the last wild Japanese crested ibises were caught. I think it was 6 of them. And they were taken in to a captive breeding program. One of those ibises was called Kin, and this is a little plaque commemorating the life of Kin, who passed away in 2003 at the age of 36. She was the last of the Japanese population of crested ibises. There was another population discovered in the mountains of Shanxi province in China, where they discovered a few individuals. And they set up a breeding program there. And Japan received some of the Chinese birds, which they started a breeding program. This is Kin, who was stuffed and is now displayed in the education center here. This is a timeline and gives you an idea of what happened in the story of the Japanese crested ibises. So in 1999, they received these birds from China. And then subsequently in 2003, Kim, the last individual from the Japanese population, died out. I was in Japan from 1999 for 5 years. I used to get an English language newspaper, and they featured stories about the Japanese crested ibises. When they had a breeding success at the center, and it was very big news in Japan. So I followed this very closely when I was living in Japan. Over 20 years later, I finally made it to Sado. And it was a bit of a dream come true for me to finally see these birds in the wild after following their story for 20 years. You can see here that the first releases onto Sado Island of captive birds were in 2008. So by the time that I went there, they've been wild birds for 12 years. And they now have a self-sustaining population and no more birds are being released. So when I went in the education center, I was met by this gentleman here who very kindly showed me around and explained the whole conservation program and the story of the crested ibis in Japan. Here are some of the exhibits. You can see kin there on the right. And they've got all sorts of educational things, videos and skeletons and pictures of the birds in flight. It's a really well set up place. There's just one little thing I want to show you here. Down on the bottom right here, you can see the original extent of the population of crested ibises. They were found in Japan, Korea, China, and then even down in Taiwan. And they became rarer and rarer and finally almost became extinct throughout the whole range. Here you can see they've got a little life-size model of a crested ibis, and they even made it the correct weight. So you can actually hold this thing and just get a feel for what it would be like to hold the real thing. So this gentleman here explained about why crested ibises had become so rare and what was being done on Sado Island to help conserve them. One of the big problems was a change in rice cultivation across East Asia. In the past, as now, sort of the rice fields were flooded and the rice was planted, but rice fields used to be kept flooded, but new strains of rice meant that these could be left to dry out. What they did to help the crested ibises was make some little ponds, shallow ponds on the side of the rice fields, and these are kept flooded. So all year long, these will hold some of the things that they eat, like little small fish and loaches and different insects and frogs. So this enables the crested ibis to survive. Nowadays, the little creeks and stuff are much lower down than the rice fields, and any wildlife in those cannot actually get up into the rice fields. So they made these very ingenious little ladders that fish can sort of swim their way up. So once the rice fields are flooded and planted, the fish from the little creeks can make their way up and populate the rice fields. The Japanese are very into little photo opportunities, as you know. So yeah, you can sort of stand behind a Japanese crested ibis on its nest or take a photo with their little mascot. Here's one little interesting sheet that showed the current population of crested ibis. You can see the bottom row there. There's 406 wild birds, and these are broken down into different areas and males and females. And on the bottom left, you see there's 406, and then 177 are the number in the breeding program. And this gives a grand total of 583 birds in Japan. So leaving the center, I drove around checking out the rice fields, and here you can see one of those nice ditches that are kept flooded for the birds to feed in. And then I started exploring and looking for some actually wild crested ibises. I finally found one flying in. You can see when they fly, they've got this beautiful peachy colored wing linings. This is called ibis color, tokiiro in Japanese, and it's a really distinctive, it's almost like a sort of cherry blossom color, just absolutely gorgeous. And here it is coming to land in a rice field, and then I had some really nice chances to take photographs of these special birds. You'll see here that they've got very gray plumage. This is actually the breeding plumage, and they breed quite early, so in February when I was there, they were well into the breeding season. This is actually a juvenile, and which is the same as a non-breeding plumage. And this is often the bird that people want to see more. It's one of the few species that is more attractive in its juvenile or non-breeding plumage. I also came across a little roosting site for these birds. Here's some footage of some birds that I came across. You can see this mixture of non-breeding and breeding individuals here. You can see they're all color banded. Here's another one flying in. See that beautiful peachy colored wing linings. But really fascinating birds. could see this one carrying around a sort of little bit of material there. And I got quite close to one, and I got some nice footage of it feeding. After observing these wonderful birds, we're going to head back to the ferry terminal and then make our way back across to Niigata City. There's one more place I want to show you on this tour. It's a little side trip that I did, and it's across to Miyagi Prefecture. So we're going to hire a car in Niigata, and we're going to make our way across to Sendai City in Miyagi Prefecture. There's a park here called Mizunomori Park that this year had a very rare bird that I went to see. And it was the solitary snipe, a very difficult bird to see, but it's regularly seen at this park. But the main reason for coming up here is to head to a large lake up here called Izunuma. And here is the wintering grounds of tens of thousands of greater white-fronted geese. It's impressive. I think there's up to 80,000 birds. And it's absolutely amazing. And with so many birds being found around here, there's often rarities that show up as well. One of the main ones that we're going to be looking for is the lesser white-fronted goose, globally threatened species. Here we are at Izunuma. It's a great place for swans. You get both Hooper and Bewick swans. Here's an interesting bird that seems to be an annual visitor now, the Aleutian subspecies of the cackling goose. This is the most numerous goose in this area. It's a greater white-fronted goose. And these are lesser white-fronted geese that we've got to try and look for in the huge flocks of greater white fronts. So here's some footage. We've got to check through these, every single bird. We've got to look through, check its bill. We're looking for a small pinkish bill and a sort of golden eye ring. I don't see one here. Let's check these birds at the front. Here we've got greater white fronts. And if you look at the back there, you can see these slightly smaller birds. One of the problems is they're often putting their heads away and having a little sleep in the day. But on that left bird, you can see there's a nice golden eye ring there. And here I found a little group out in the open. See that small bill and the eye ring. But yeah, very difficult bird to see. And this has really turned out to be one of the best places in the world to see it. At dusk, tens of thousands of geese that have been feeding in the rice fields around all come in to roost on this huge lake, and then we get ourselves into position and watch them all flying in. It's a really impressive spectacle. And here you can hear this absolute cacophony of geese flying overhead. It's really one of the most impressive natural sounds in Japan. But it's going to be a wonderful way to finish the trip. And from Izunuma, we're going to head back down to Sendai City. And again here, we're going to jump back on the bullet train to Tokyo. Here's Sendai JR Station. It's quite far, but it's like, I think it's about an hour and 40 minutes back to Tokyo. Just to give you an idea how quick this thing travels, last time I was in Japan with my family, we went to a station where there was a bullet train going by without stopping, and yeah, I just want to show you this.
Bullet train, you look.
So we're gonna go very quickly back to Tokyo, where we're going to end the tour. Okay, that's the end of the tour. Going to leave you with a picture of one of my favorite birds in the world, the crested ibis, showing its beautiful peachy wing linings. Many thanks to the people that have allowed me to use their photos for this virtual tour, and thank you very much for watching. Don't forget to check out our other virtual tours, and many thanks for your support.